Hi, this is Raphael Mudge, the creator of Cobalt Strike, and you're watching Lecture 3 of the Penetration Testing with Cobalt Strike series. This is the lecture on client-side attack. Here's what we're going to talk about in this lecture. I'm going to talk about system profiling, which is a client-side reconnaissance capability in Cobalt Strike. I'm going to show you how to attack a network using client-side vulnerabilities. I'm also going to talk about how to defeat firewall egress situations and talk about listener management and payloads. And then, in case attacking with vulnerabilities isn't good enough, I'm going to show you how to attack with features. Here's where we're at in the process. Again, we're going to talk about reconnaissance for client-side attacks and client-side attack. Here's the client-side attack process. First, let me define client-side attack for those listening at home, if you will. In the last lecture, I said that remote exploits are becoming fewer and far between. They're much harder to find now, right? Well, what as an attacker can we touch? Anything we can touch is fair game. Since remote services have been pretty much ruled out thanks to firewalls and things like that, if we're able to get a user to open a file or click a link, that program that they use to view our links, their web browser, and the programs that they use to view the files we send them, they're fair game for exploitation. And client-side attack is exploiting those applications that run on the workstations, attacking the clients, okay? Here's the process. Step one, profile the system. Think of Cobalt Strike System Profiler as being like Nmap for client-side attack. Step two, once you know something about your target's attack surface and what they're running, stage a virtual machine with those applications. Also, if you've discovered through your information gathering or other reconnaissance which antivirus solution they're using, I highly foot stomp, I will dance on my head right now, recommend that you install that solution on that virtual machine. Okay? Step three. This is the part that you get paid for as penetration tester, the big bucks. You have to test out every attack you can think of and see what's going to work, what's actually going to execute on their station, on their system, what's going to be the least intrusive attack, and more importantly, what is going to beat the security products that they have installed. Step four, set up the attack and ready it for use. And step five, deliver it. We're going to talk a bit about step four in this lecture, and step five we're going to talk more about in the next lecture on social engineering. But let's go ahead and get right into it. Let's start out with reconnaissance. Cobalt Strike's System Profiler is a web application. You have to get your target to visit it somehow, okay? What it does is through the browser, it discovers the different client-side applications that the visitor is running. It's able to pick out the version of Adobe Flash, QuickTime, Adobe Reader, the browser, the operating system, and a few other things as well. It also discovers the internal IP address. You're not just looking at the NAT device that they went through, or their proxy, but in the case of Firefox and Internet Explorer, it's usually able to peer inside and give you some more information as well. Finally, the system profiler is capable of cross-referencing all the application information with the exploits in Metasploit and either giving you a client-side vulnerability report or just recommending which exploits you can try. Okay, Here we are back in Cobalt Strike. Let's have a look at the system profiler. Go to Attacks, Web Drive By, System Profiler. Here, Cobalt Strike is going to ask us the local path to bind to. I'm going to put in /recon/. I'm going to have Cobalt Strike start the web server with the system profiler on port 80. And I'm also going to set a redirect URL. You may be wondering, what's the redirect URL feature for? Here's how I use it. When I was penetration testing, I used to like to send LinkedIn invitations. I would send a small group of people some LinkedIn invitations. I would say, hey, like Bob Jones wants to connect. And any link in the email would lead to my system profiler. Once the profile was complete, I redirected my targets onto LinkedIn.com. My hope was to disguise the fact that I was doing my recon shot and not to raise suspicions. So that's the purpose of the redirect URL. As soon as the profile is complete, Cobalt Strike will send the visitor to this other address. To launch it, just go ahead and click Launch. And there we go. The system profiler is now started. Let me just go ahead and copy and paste that URL. Press OK. Now, if you want to view all the traffic going to Cobalt Strike, go to View, Weblog. Here we are. Now, let me go ahead and redirect or send a few visitors over to our system profiler. Here's one. You can see their browser grabbing some information. And there we go. We must have gotten something back. And there's the post of the data. And we can see now two hosts, 10.10.10.189 and 192.168.12.110. Let me send another client over from the same network. You can see some more activity going on from 192.168.12.110 again. And we now have another host, 10.10.10.188. Curious. I'll let all the web traffic go, but if you go to View, Applications, here's the data collected by the system profiler. You'll notice it's grabbed the external IP address, which both of these hosts have the same one, meaning they're coming through the same proxy or NAT device, but they both have different internal IP addresses. This tells me that these are two different hosts inside of that network. Now you'll also notice that both of these hosts have pretty similar profiles. That's very normal in a homogeneous corporate network, okay? Now it's kind of fun about Cobalt Strike is I can highlight an application and go to Show Exploits, and Cobalt Strike will actually highlight the different exploits relevant to that particular application. I can also highlight all the applications, hit Show Exploits, and get back more information. Now what I'd like to show you real quick is what the system profiling experience looks like from the perspective of a victim. Here we are. This is Mozilla Firefox on my Macintosh. I'm going to send Firefox to the system profiler. Here you can see it's loading and I'm now at LinkedIn.com. Here we are back in Cobalt Strike. You can see that my Macintosh has now appeared. And if I press refresh, I now have another host listed. Some more exploit opportunities here as well. We'll get into that. So that's the system profiler. The last thing I'd like to show you is the client-side vulnerability report, because you can think of Cobalt Strike's System Profiler as a light vulnerability scanner for client-side vulnerabilities. Just go to View, Reporting, Client Vulnerability Report. Hit Export, dump this to the desktop, hit Save. And let's have a quick look at that report. Okay, here's the Cobalt Strike client-side report. As usual, you can click on any of the vulnerabilities, jump right to them, get those nice bookmarks. Here we get the actual vulnerability, description of the module, all the hosts that are vulnerable, including the software they're running, its version, the external and internal IP address. This way you're not turning over to your client saying, hey, look, I was able to get all these hosts to visit me, but all I've got is the proxy information. Good luck. This is a little bit more meaningful. And just like in the normal vulnerability report, we also have all the references. You can click on those as well. So this is the client-side vulnerability report in Cobalt Strike. The other nice thing about this report is it's generated from a system profile alone. So if you have a client that won't allow social engineering to be in scope, maybe you can convince them to let you launch a spear phishing campaign and turn in the client-side vulnerability report as one of the products of that campaign. Just a thought. Before we launch into how to set up a client-side attack, I'd just like to point out a few common client-side exploits. Just like remote exploits, there are a few gems that you should be aware of. Java signed applet's a particular favorite. This is a feature, not really an exploit, but what it does is it prompts the user saying, hey, do you want to give this applet full permission to run? If the user clicks yes, then we as the attackers, we now have access to that system. Another great attack is the Java Rhino exploit. It's like the Java signed applet attack, except instead of prompting the user, it takes advantage of a loophole in the Java API to disable the security sandbox and give us access without having to prompt the user. This is a pretty exciting attack because it works on Mac OS X, Linux, Windows, anywhere Java is installed and an applet can run. Another good exploit is MS-11003IE_CSS_import. This one works great against Internet Explorer 7 and 8. It was patched about a year ago, but if a system doesn't have up-to-date patches, this is a great exploit. IE_createObject is also a great one for Internet Explorer 6. These are just a few to try out and be aware of. Here we are back in Cobalt Strike. Why don't we put some of these exploits to use? Now, what's kind of cool about the Show Exploits feature is it relies on this version string, but in the case of Internet Explorer, it also looks at some other data to try to take a good guess at the patch level of Internet Explorer. Cobalt Strike does this because this version string for IE does not update as you install, as the target installs patches. Something to be aware of. So I'm going to highlight everything, hit Show Exploits, and here's everything we have to work with. Great. We're going to launch two of these. First, let's launch the Java_Rhino attack. I'm going to double-click the exploit, and now we have a module launcher dialog. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to change the serve port to port 443. I'm also going to change the path to /Rhino. The payload's already configured for me. Now, when I click launch, Cobalt Strike will start a web server through Metasploit on port 443. I can't do port 80 because the system profiler is already running on 80. Cobalt Strike specific features can run on one port, and Metasploit stuff launched through Cobalt Strike has to run on another one. So I'm going to click launch, and there we go. The server started. Let's go ahead and have a look at this exploit in action, if you will. Here we are in Firefox on my Macintosh. Let's go ahead and click on this link and see what happens. You'll notice a whole lot of nothing. We didn't get prompted for anything. Nothing has happened. You may have noticed if you looked in the lower left-hand corner, go ahead and rewind, you may notice that applet exploit has started. Let's go to Cobalt Strike and see what things look like from Cobalt Strike's perspective. Here we are. We have the lightning bolts around the Macintosh. Okay? Pretty cool. Now, let's see what happens if we try to exploit these Windows hosts. If I hit Show Exploits, these Windows hosts are running an up-to-date version of Java, so we don't see that Rhino exploit in their case. But we do see this MS-11003 and 050 exploits. I'm going to launch the MS-11003 IE CSS import exploit. There we go. Same drill as before. I'll change the serve port to 443. Change the URI path to IE. And click launch. And let's watch what happens. I've just clicked on that link with one of my Windows 7 workstations in my 1010 network. And there we go. We have a session. You'll notice that the session shows up on this 192.168.12.110. The reason being is because this is the NAT device, or firewall, or proxy, we really don't know. But we do know that that is the IP presented to us, and so that's what Metasploit sees as the IP address for the host. So that's an example of a client-side attack using Cobalt Strike. I've shown you how to perform reconnaissance, pick a client-side attack, set it up, and launch it. Let's talk about antivirus for a moment. Some AV products do a pretty good job of hooking into the browser and stopping browser-based exploits. You are not alone in this fight. However, this is your fight. First, in the Cobalt Strike module launcher dialog, if you click Show Advanced Options, it's a checkbox, you will see a lot more options in that table. There are a series of http:// options that you can set to obfuscate the attack. In my personal experience, I've had limited success defeating the security products I've tested against using this option. Okay? Another option, this requires some programming though, is to look at the source code for the attack in the Metasploit framework, take your test virtual machine, and keep modifying the attack until you figure out what the attack or what the product, the security product, triggers on. The way to do this is to just keep selectively commenting out parts of the exploit, even though it won't trigger, just keep commenting out pieces until you figure out what it hooks into. Once you've figured that out, change it so that the exploit works, but it's not detected. I have done this. It does. This is a process that works. It should take you about 2 or 3 hours. If you've got a programmer, this is certainly something viable to pursue. Your last option is to use another attack. So far, we've talked a lot about exploits in this series. In a moment, I'm going to talk about how to defeat firewall egress situations, and then I'm going to talk about how to attack with features. So if you find yourself in a position where your exploit is being caught by antivirus or some other product, either pick a new exploit or resort to attacking with features. The presence of these products is why it is so important to perform good reconnaissance before launching your attack. So moving on in this lecture, let's talk about listeners for a moment. You may recall when I was talking about Metasploit modules way back in the first lecture that I mentioned that once we get code execution, a payload executes, and that payload then connects back to a listening multi-handler. And if it connects successfully, we get a session, right? Well, in the real world, sometimes in a pen test, we'll encounter this nice thing called a firewall. It's very possible I may have done my job as a pen tester. I may have chosen the right attack. I may have, through whatever means I tried, beaten the security proc that's installed. I may have even achieved code execution on the host I compromised. However, it's very possible that the firewall might stop me dead in my tracks. Okay? Here, you can see that this payload is hypothetically trying to establish a TCP connection over port 35,675. And of course, the firewall says, "Who are you?" and stops it. No session. What can we do in these situations? Well, an option is to figure out what passes through the firewall. In just about any network now, many networks will allow common ports out. They'll allow, sometimes depending, they might allow out SSH, port 22. Some are really tightly locked down, but they'll allow out ports 80 and 443. Those are a favorite. Some networks are extremely locked down and won't allow anything out except through a proxy device. That's a hard situation to deal with, but you have to be aware of it. And for a network to be functional, depending on the kind of network it is, it's probably connected to the internet somehow. So let's talk about how to defeat these situations. To defeat these egress situations, we need to choose the right payload. Here are several Metasploit payloads you should be aware of. Windows Meterpreter Reverse TCP connects out to one port of your choosing. Windows Meterpreter Bind TCP, once it runs on a host, it opens up a listener and waits for us to connect back to it. If you see bind in a payload's name, that means it is waiting for a connection. Reverse means the payload is connecting back to us, to our listener. If connecting back to one port doesn't work, you can try all ports. That's what Windows Meterpreter Reverse TCP All Ports does. It tries every single port in sequence. This is one you probably won't use very often. Once the listener is set up, you actually have to configure your local firewall to route all connections to you, the attacker, back to that one listener. The other problem with this, besides the cumbersome setup, is once this payload runs, it's going to look like a port scan from inside your target's network trying to leave and scan something out on the internet. It's very likely this will get caught. So you can use reverse TCP. You can set it to port 80. You can set it to port 443. That might work. One challenge you might encounter. I mentioned, what if they've got tight egress? What if nothing's allowed out? Well, if your client happens to have a transparent proxy server, you can use the Windows Meterpreter reverse HTTPS payload. This payload, it speaks HTTPS. It looks like a browser talking to a web server. Most transparent proxies will let it through. It says, hey, you're speaking my language. Have a good time. Also, besides Windows Meterpreter, there's Java Meterpreter. I mentioned way back in lecture one that next to the Windows Meterpreter, Java Meterpreter is the most full-featured and stable of the Meterpreter clan. Java Meterpreter can connect back on, you know, a reverse TCP connection. It can do reverse HTTPS, reverse HTTP. So there's a lot of egress options with Java Meterpreter as well. Now, if for some reason you need to create a listener specifically for Linux or OS X, there are payloads that will give you a shell once they connect back. Linux x86 shell reverse TCP and OS X x86 shell reverse TCP. These are some of the payloads you should be aware of. Now let's talk about listener management in Cobalt Strike. One of the pains, if you set up a bunch of listeners because you know the situations you want to feed, and if for some reason you take your Cobalt Strike infrastructure down, it's kind of tedious having to set everything back up again. This is why Cobalt Strike has persistent listeners. If you go to Cobalt Strike listeners, you'll get a nice dialog where you can actually manage all of your persistent listeners from. The idea is set them up once, they're always available. And you can use these listeners with your client-side tech and with social engineering packages as well. Here in this dialog, I'm giving a listener name reverse HTTP listener, and of course I'm doing Windows Meterpreter reverse HTTP on port 80. If you check the automatically migrate session box with Windows Meterpreter, Meterpreter will automatically migrate to a new process once a session is established. This mitigates the problem if you exploit a browser and the user closes it. You'll still keep your connection if you migrate. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. Let's go ahead and take a look at creating listeners. Cobalt Strike, listeners. To add a listener, just click Add. Let's give this one a name. We'll make this Windows Meterpreter. And I'm going to call this one IRC because I'm going to give it the port 6667, just like IRC. And we'll make this one be Windows Meterpreter reverse TCP. And I'm also going to have this one migrate automatically. Press save to add the listener. And there we go. We now have a listener on port 6667. Now let's go ahead and add a Java Meterpreter listener. Call this one Java Meterpreter SSH. And we'll do Java Meterpreter reverse TCP, port 22. Press save. And we have a new listener. And I'll add one more for giggles. Let's add Windows Meterpreter reverse TCP. It's up to you what you name these. I name them this way just so I know what they are at a glance. And we'll make this one port 21 and we'll save it. There we go. We have three listeners. One thing I'd like to show you is how to use a listener in a client-side exploit. Here's the module launcher for MS-11003. If you see a box next to an option name, that means you can double-click that option to launch a helper to help you set it. Notice all these values are set a certain way. Watch. I'm going to double-click this. Cobalt Strike is going to open up a dialog that lets me choose which of my existing listeners I want to use. And I can choose the Windows Meterpreter listener, press choose, and you'll notice that Cobalt Strike has updated the payload options for this attack. Okay? So that's an example of how to use a persistent listener with a client-side exploit. Now that you know how to start up listeners and think about defeating firewall egress situations, let's talk about attacking with features. It's very likely that in a hardened network, an organization that is truly ready for a double-blind penetration test and what you're going to throw at them with Cobalt Strike, it's possible that Metasploit's public database of exploits is burned. Okay, that's fine. That's not going to stop us. Let's talk about our options. One option is to create an executable and get a trusted insider to run it, or fool a user into running it. The way you do this is any listener, any payload in Cobalt Strike, you can actually turn into an executable. The problem is an executable by itself might be suspicious. So there's a few things you can do to dress it up. You can change its icon with an icon editing program and maybe rename it to something else. Another option that Cobalt Strike can help you with is you can take some Windows executables, doesn't work with all of them, but you can take some Windows executables and embed Meterpreter directly into them. And then maybe you can get that executable to a user somehow, and if they run it, voila, you'll have access. Like I said though before, antivirus isn't always our friend. We do have some options though when it comes to generating executables. If you want to beat antivirus, Metasploit comes with several encoders and Cobalt Strike helps you use them. All you have to do is encode the binary, test it out against the AV you're interested in. If it passes, good. If it doesn't, go back, generate another binary, and keep repeating this approach until you get something that works. If you use an exotic template executable, you might be able to bypass antivirus this way by both encoding Meterpreter and embedding it into something that AV just gives up on looking at. If neither of these options work, then here's where a programmer comes in handy. You'll have to create an executable, your own, write a program, that somehow includes Meterpreter inside of it, and then use that. If you want to learn more about this process, go take a read at Facts and Myth about Antivirus Evasion with Metasploit. It's a great tutorial on how to do this. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. Let me show you how to generate an executable and how to disguise it. To generate an executable, go to Attacks, Packages, Windows Executable. This Packages menu is where all the social engineering packages of Cobalt Strike are kept. Click the menu and make sure that the host is what you want the target to connect back to. Choose a listener. Cobalt Strike will present the relevant listeners that you've set up. If you haven't set any up, you can click Add. We'll use the IRC one in this case. If you want to use a template, you can. You can choose an encoder as well. You can choose not to encode a payload, or you can choose to use Ashkata Ganai. And let's say, for example, I'm going to do that icon changing trick I talked about earlier. Let's do that first. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to generate three executables. Here's a way to do that quickly. Set your options as you'd like them, hold down Shift, and click Generate. By holding down Shift, Cobalt Strike will go through the process of generating the executables, but it won't actually, but Cobalt Strike won't change things on me, okay? So let's go ahead and give this, we'll call this bd1.exe, okay? Save, good. Hold down Shift, generate. And what we're doing is we're generating three different backdoor files, all encoded differently with Shikata Ganai, okay, but all using the same parameters we were interested in. This is just a nice time-saving measure for quickly generating executables, okay? And of course, if you hit generate and don't hold down shift, this dialog will close. So let's go ahead and close that for a moment. And let's look at disguising these backdoor files. One kind of cool program for doing this is IcoFX. What IcoFX does, it's an icon editor. It's free. First thing I'm going to do is extract an icon from an executable. I'm going to go to Tools. Oops, excuse me. File, Extract. And let me look at Adobe Reader. Program files, Adobe Reader 9.0, and go into Reader, and I want to say it's AcroRead 32 is going to have what we're looking for. It does not. Let's go File, Extract. Let's try AcroRead32.dll since DLLs can hold icons too. And there we go. Bingo. Click Extract to pull the icon out. And let's just go ahead and save it. Save as Desktop. We'll call it Adobe Reader Icon. Okay, save. Great, now I've got an icon. Now let's camouflage one of my backdoor executables. Tools. Resource editor, open up the executable. In this case, we'll choose BD2. To add an icon, just click Add Icon, choose that Adobe Reader icon, and save it. There we go. BD2 now has an Adobe PDF icon. Looks like a PDF document. Pretty cool. Another trick I'd like to show you is how to use a template executable. Here's how. Attacks, packages, Windows executable. Okay? We've been here before. Keep our listener. Let's go ahead and choose a template. Go to my desktop. I'm going to choose putty.exe as my template. Okay? I'm also going to tell Cobalt Strike to attempt to preserve the template's functionality, meaning when this executable runs, hopefully it'll function like normal, but also run Meterpreter for us. Click Generate. And here we go. I'm going to call this puttyevil.exe. Hit save. And let's go look at the desktop. I now have putty.exe and puttyevil.exe. Because I merged it with a template executable, it took on all the metadata of putty. If you were to right-click and look at the file's properties, nobody would fault you for thinking that this was PuTTY, the PuTTY that we all love, okay? All the same metadata. Now, let's see what happens when this PuTTY is run on a target. Here we are on a Windows 7 target. I'm going to open up this evil PuTTY. You'll notice we have PuTTY. I can do whatever I like with this PuTTY, like maybe log into a host. Let's go ahead and try that out. Not worried about that. Okay, great. Now, you would think everything's normal, right? Let's go back to Cobalt Strike. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. We now have lightning bolts. We have a session. Jumping ahead to lecture 5 material, let's take a screenshot just to see what life is looking like for our victim. Right click, Meterpreter, Explore, Screenshot. Oh look, our target is interacting with a host through the backdoored evil PuTTY, the same one that gave us a Meterpreter session when run. So that's an example of using Cobalt Strike to backdoor an existing executable. Let's talk about another attack. It doesn't have to be an executable. You can use a document that helps you get code execution on the compromised host. A really great way to do this is through macros in Office documents. To add a macro to an Office document, just go ahead and generate Meterpreter in a VBA format through Cobalt Strike. Add it to the document, save it as a macro-enabled document, and deliver. Let's have a look at what this looks like. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. I'm going to go to Attacks, Packages, Microsoft Office Macro. Once I click this, you'll notice I get the usual suspects of listeners. Let me go ahead and hit Generate. And Cobalt Strike is now telling me how to add a macro to a Microsoft Word or Excel document. It wants us to open up Microsoft Word or Excel. This works in both. And I'm going to take you through each of these steps. I've got them memorized. But first, let me copy the macro to my clipboard by pressing Copy Macro. Great. Let's do it. Okay, here we are in Microsoft Excel. I could use an existing Excel spreadsheet, okay? But in this case, I'll just add some garbage to this one. I don't really have to do this, I'm just doing it for appearances. I want you to know that this is not an exploit, we're just using a feature of Excel. Now to add a macro, go to View, Macros, View Macros, change macros in option to book one, which is this workbook basically. Give the macro a name, it doesn't matter, blah will work. Press create. Clear the editor. Paste in the macro. That's the whole thing. Close the macro editor. Go to File. Save as, put this on the desktop, I'll call it evil document, and make sure you save it as a macro-enabled workbook. Click save. And that's it. Same thing we just did, view macros. We changed macros into the current file, gave it a name, click create, cleared the editor, pasted, close the macro editor, save the document. That's all you have to do. Now, let's move this document over to a target and let's see what happens when they execute it. Here we are on our target virtual machine. I'm going to open up this evil document. It doesn't matter whether I grabbed it over the internet or how I got it. Now, I get the security warning saying macros have been disabled. To enable them, I press enable content. You may be asking, who would do that? More people than you think. My girlfriend doesn't know what macros are, and so she's mentioned that she sees it, she presses it. Hey, I need to use this file, enable content. Another thing to point out is that if I were to use this Excel spreadsheet that people expected to have macros, say some sort of Excel game or a calculator for something complex, that's more likely to get folks to press enable content as well. Or maybe I could do something like, hey, to see the rest of this data, to decrypt it, press enable content. It's up to you to come up with the creative part, if you will, of how to get the person to click the button. But once I pressed enabled content, that macro inserted Meterpreter directly into memory without ever touching disk, except for the macro that's embedded in the document. Let's go back to Cobalt Strike. Here we are in Cobalt Strike, and we have a session on the host that opened the macro document. Again, let's go ahead and take a look at a screenshot of that target just to see. And here we are. Our target is viewing an Excel document right now. That's an example of the macro attack. Now, this lecture is being recorded in February 2012. Recently, I tested this attack, and I was able to beat a fully patched system with a fully up-to-date Microsoft Security Essentials and get right past it, no problem. This is why it pays to pay attention to all of your options, test them out, and see what works. Right now, this is a great attack. I would be using this in penetration tests. Tomorrow, it may be something else. But there's always something. Let's talk about PDF files. PDF files are a particular favorite target of a lot of people. Cobalt Strike, you can generate, take an existing PDF file, add an executable to it, and when opened, the user will be prompted with some strange things, but if they agree to the prompts, we'll get code execution using features in Adobe Reader. Here we are in Cobalt Strike. Let's demo that PDF capability. Go to Attacks, Packages, Adobe PDF. Here, I can customize the message the user is going to see. You'll see what it looks like from a user perspective. I can pick a PDF file. Let's say I happen to be penetration testing a security vendor who might want to know about Cobalt Strike. Since it's not out yet, maybe I can hook somebody if I send them the Cobalt Strike spec sheet. You know, people love seeing marketing materials for unreleased products. Now let's embed an executable. We'll do that backdoor 2 one that we generated earlier. I knew I had a use for that executable. And all I have to do now is press generate. It's asking me where I want to save the document. We'll call it Cobalt Leaked. .pdf. Press save. And we now have a shiny PDF that we can deliver to a victim. Let's see what happens when a target opens up this PDF file. Here we are on my Windows XP target. It has to be Windows XP because this particular feature of Adobe Reader only works on Windows XP. I have a Cobalt leaked document on my desktop. Let's go ahead and double click it, see what happens. Now first, I'm prompted to click Save. Okay, fine. I'm now asked if I want to view the encrypted content, please check the Do Not Show This Message Again box and press Open. Okay, fine. I don't know what just happened, but something happened. But I got a nice PDF file I can enjoy. It's pretty cool. I think it's telling me I should buy Cobalt Strike. Here we are, back in Cobalt Strike. And you'll notice I have a session on this Windows XP box. If I right click, I actually have two sessions. Probably as I opened the document twice. You saw me do it once, that's when I did it right. The other time I fumbled. That's the joys of editing, by the way. Anyways, standard operating procedure. Let's go to Explore, Screenshot. Let's take a look at what we've got. Here's a picture of our target's desktop, and here they are looking at that Cobalt Strike document. So that's an example of the Adobe Reader embedded executable attack. It's not my favorite attack because it's not very subtle, but it is there. Another nice thing about this attack is you can use any executable you'd like, okay? So you can either generate Meterpreter into an executable and use that, or if you've got some other executable, some other package, you can use that as well. Okay, another attack I'd like you to be aware of is the signed applet attack. Go to Attacks, Web Drive By, Signed Applet Attack. And through this dialog, you can set up the Java signed applet client-side exploit. If you really want this to be effective, purchase a code signing certificate. They run about $100, $200, and use that to sign the applet to make it more convincing. You know, the user will say, hey, this is verified by so-and-so, and they may be more likely to click grant me all the privileges. It's also possible through Cobalt Strike to spit out Java Meterpreter as a Java jar file. Just go to Attacks, Packages, Java Application. This will generate a jar file, and anywhere you can use a jar file with whatever attack means you've got, use it. Here's an example of using Java Meterpreter in an attack. Let's create a macOS 10 Trojan. The Cobalt Strike option for this merges Java Meterpreter with a macOS 10 application file. Okay, so it basically makes Java Meterpreter look like an OS 10 application. Here we are on my Macintosh. I've got Cobalt Strike up and running. And let's go ahead and let's get an icon. Here's the way you can do that. Pick an application that you're interested in. In this case, I'll choose Microsoft Word. Right-click, Show Package Contents. Navigate into there. Go to, let's see here, Resources. What I'm doing right now is looking for a convincing icon to use in my attack. Okay? So many nice icons. I think we'll use this one. Looks good to me. So I'm going to do is copy this icon and we'll save it to this folder here. Okay? Now, let's proceed to create a macOS 10 Trojan through Cobalt Strike. Go to Attacks, Packages, macOS 10 Trojan. Again, our listeners are already running. This one uses Java Meterpreter. Let me select an icon file. I'm going to select that icon I just saved, hit open, and now click generate. I can give this application whatever name I like. Let's call this Raphael's resume.docx. Okay, hit save. Cobalt Strike has now generated a macOS 10 Trojan that is Raphael's resume.docx.app. If you zip it up and send it to somebody, here's what they're going to see when they extract it. There we go. Just took a minute for it to catch on. They changed the icon of it. They're going to see Raphael's resume.docx. If they double click it, let's watch what happens. There we go. We've got lightning bolts. Now, what Cobalt Strike did in this case is it created a shell of a macOS 10 application for a Java app, inserted Java interpreter, and used the icon we provided to create a convincing looking Trojan. It also did some fancy stuff to prevent macOS 10 from displaying the .app extension on this file. So that's an example of a macOS 10 Trojan generated through Cobalt Strike. Okay, in this lecture, I've taken you through the client-side attack process. We talked about system profiling, which is a means of doing client-side reconnaissance. I also showed you how to pick and choose which client vulnerability or which client-side exploit to use. I also talked about how to evade antivirus. It's not trivial, but that's why we're paid the big bucks as pen testers, right? But it can be done. I also showed you how to set up listeners and choose listeners appropriately to defeat certain types of tight firewall egress situations. I also showed you how to create different kinds of convincing social engineering packages using Cobalt Strike's tools. I showed you the macOS 10 Trojan, which even though it's built into Cobalt Strike, I hope it helps prompt your imagination into thinking of ways you can disguise Meterpreter executable or jar file to get code execution on a target system. This concludes Lecture 3 of Penetration Testing with Cobalt Strike.